I had heard Elvis on the radio. I was living in the Muscle Shoals area of North Alabama, and I would hear him on the radio. And one day, a kid at school came up to me, an underclassman. He came up and said, "Norbert, I have to talk to you." And I said, "What about?" "I'm putting a band together to play some of this Sun Records stuff, this Carl Perkins, Johnny Cash, Elvis Presley." I said, "Well, great, let me know how it turns out." You know, he goes, no, wait a second. He says, "I want you to be the bass player." I said, "I don't know anything about playing the bass." "Your father has one." "Well, it's true, my father had played bass when he was a young man." I said, "Well, doesn't anyone else in school have one?" "No, you're it, you have to be the bass player." And so then I said, trying to weasel out of this thing, matter of fact, I repeated this story to Elvis Presley at Stax Studios in Memphis many years later when we were sitting on a drum riser having lunch at midnight. You know, he was nocturnal in those days. And I said, "Elvis," I said, "so Danny says to me, you have to be the band." And I said, "Well, what makes you think overnight I can do this?" And Danny Cross says, "This Elvis Presley stuff only has three chords. It's E, A, and B. Surely to God you can find three notes." And I thought, well, perhaps I could. And Elvis leaned over and he said, "Hey, Putt, if I'd been Sinatra, you would have had a chance." Frank has some very complicated. But anyway, that's how I began. And I went to my father, and he said, "Well, this is the way you tune it up, but I don't want you to get involved in this music stuff, kid." And so we tuned up my bass. And I said, "Well, you want to show me a few things?" He goes, "No." He said, "I don't want you involved in music. I wasted years," he said, "as a young man trying to make it in music. It's impossible. Matter of fact," he says, "I can tell you, you will never make any money as a musician." And I said, "Oh, okay." Well, I never forgot that he said that, because it was the most encouraging thing he could have possibly said to me. Because every time I thought my career was struggling, I remember what he said, and I thought, I can't let him be right, you know? If my father had said, "I want to support you," I don't think I would have ever gotten anywhere. But anyway, that was my first, I would come home from school every day, and I would go to my room, and I had one of those little RCA 45 players, and I would put on my Scotty and Bill stuff, and I would slap bass with Bill Black. You know, Bill Black was the bass player with Elvis. And it was just the two of them, Scotty Moore and Bill. And Bill would play, boom, chick, chick. He'd play a note and hit the neck twice. So he'd go, boom, chick, boom, chick, boom, chick, boom. He was hitting it. It took me 4 months to learn to do that, okay? And so we join up with these boys and we start playing sock hops at school. And it was unbelievable. It was pandemonium. And we played, I guess, all of that summer when I was 15. And the next year, David Briggs and I decide that we want to start an R&B band, because the music that the young kids mostly listened to when I was young in the late 50s was more likely to be James Brown. Now you can dance to that. So we join up with Jerry Kerrigan. We form an R&B band. A young man named Dan Pennington from Vernon, Alabama becomes our singer. He later writes, oh, he wrote "Do Right Man, Do Right Woman" for Aretha. He produced the letter. And and so we're running around now at the age of 16 playing fraternity parties at Ole Miss and Alabama, Auburn, Mississippi State. And Dan had this really soulful, blue-eyed soul voice. And he can do James Brown. He can do Ray Charles, okay? We do Hank Ballard and the Midnighters, Chubby Checker. And so now we got horns in the band. And so between my 16th and 18th year, every weekend on a Friday and Saturday night, we were running around Alabama with a station wagon and a trailer. Jerry's father was our manager, and he had a driver's license. That was helpful. And so we're playing R&B music, and we meet up with a fellow in Muscle Shoals and named Tom Stafford, who's obviously delusional. He's a much older guy. He must have been 10 years older. And Tom had dreams of starting a publishing company and building a recording studio in Florence, Alabama. And we knew that was impossible, because we're a little town far away from Nashville and Memphis and New Orleans and Chicago and here. That's where you had to go to make music, right? But Tom was convinced, and one day he brought us the bellhop from the Sheffield Hotel, a fellow named Arthur Alexander. Arthur had a couple of songs that Tom thought could be good songs. And those songs, the songs were later recorded by the Beatles and Rolling Stones, only a few years later, okay? And so I learned about Elvis and got into playing with Scotty and Bill, and then sort of forgot about Elvis as I got into the R&B scene. And by the time I started to college at the age of 19, a fellow named Rick Hall has decided to produce Arthur Alexander. And we went into a warehouse that Rick had rented over in Muscle Shoals City. And Muscle Shoals was an area by the hydroelectric dams that were built on the Tennessee River in the 1920s. These huge dams produced a massive amount of electricity that wasn't even needed, or couldn't even be sent far enough to be needed. Henry Ford and Thomas Edison came down, and they'd started to lay out Muscle Shoals City to put their factories there. And then 1929 happened, okay? So we were over there in this old abandoned warehouse, and it took us a day and a half because one of the things that, although we were a good cover band, one of the things we hadn't spent a lot of time on was inventing an original part on an original song, see? So it took us a day and a half to do three songs. This record, by the way, he brings it up to Nashville, makes a deal with Dot Records, a small label out in Hendersonville. Now, Dot's okay. They've got one major act, a guy named Pat Boone. But for some reason, they took a chance on, and this is a record that if you heard it today, you'd say, well, that's sort of akin to something the Drifters might have been doing then, you know? Because the beat, I was playing, doom, 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 bum, bum, boom, da, doom, ka, cha, doom. Well, yeah, so it could have been on Broadway. But he brings it up, he makes a deal with Dot, and 2 months later, it's in the top 20 in America, okay? And we're aghast at all this, you know? I'm still in school, and we're driving around it. It's on the radio. This is a small miracle. This doesn't happen to a bunch of kids in a little town. But it did happen, and Rick Hall made $35,000 in profit off that and built the Fame studio that when you go to Muscle Shoals, you might see. It'd be worthy of a trip. So I drop out of college the next year to become a member of the first Muscle Shoals rhythm section. And we started, our second hit was a group called the Tams. What kind of fool do you think I am, okay? Great record, okay? So now we were validated. We had two hits, and then we had a third hit. And then a young guy named Tommy Rowe came down who was a bubblegum singer, sort of like a Buddy Holly type. Jing, 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 jing. And we had a couple of big hits with Tommy. And he goes to Europe, and as a young band, it opens this tour in Europe from Germany, okay? A couple of guys from Liverpool. He comes back and he's got a tape. I shouldn't bore you with all. We're trying to talk about Elvis. That's all in my book, okay? But we end up, we were their opening band for the first Beatles concert because the Beatles had all these recordings by the Muscle Shoals guys, you see. So that's how my career started. But I don't meet Elvis until I leave Muscle Shoals in '65 to come to Nashville.